What if there was a fuel so dense that 11 basketball-sized spheres could power a city like Austin, Texas for over 2 years, and so abundant it could power the entire world for tens of thousands of years? A nuclear process physically incapable of a meltdown, and one that produces a tiny fraction of the waste, which becomes safe in just a few hundred years instead of 100,000. This is the promise of thorium, and it's been on the sideline for decades, but it might just have its time in the sun. What's real? What's hype, and what's the actual catch? Let's figure this out together. I'm Ricky, and this is 2-Bit Da Vinci. This video is brought to you by Jackery. First, what is thorium? Its elemental number is 90 on the periodic table and a fuel source for nuclear power that has been researched since the 1950s. The list of benefits for thorium compared to traditional nuclear fuel, which is mostly made of uranium, is endless. Thorium is about 3 to 4 times more abundant in the Earth's crust than natural uranium, but less than 1% of natural uranium is uranium-235, the type that we can actually use in reactors. That means, effectively, thorium is almost 500 times more abundant than uranium-235. We literally move tons of thorium by accident when we're mining for other things like rare earth materials for our electronics. China's thorium reserves are enough to power the entire country for the next 20,000 years. But its real superpower is energy density. Burning 1 ton of thorium, which is a manageable volume about half the size of a small bathtub, is equivalent to burning 24 million barrels of oil. This volume is so large that it would fill AT&T Stadium in Arlington, Texas to the brim and still have leftovers to fill 350 Olympic swimming pools. Or in terms of coal, that's like burning roughly 6 million tons of it, which is enough to fill AT&T Stadium 2.5 times over. The numbers are just staggering. It blows every other fuel source completely out of the water. And there are still two more benefits to thorium. One, it's safer than other nuclear fuels because it's not a radioactive metal like uranium that's full of dangerous radioactive daughter elements. Thorium nuclear reactors are inherently safe. There's absolutely no risk of meltdowns, runaway reactions, or explosions, and we'll get back to why that is here in a minute. And finally, the thing that's probably on the back of your mind, like many others, is waste. It almost solves the problem of nuclear waste by producing a much safer type of waste that only remains radioactive for about 300 to 500 years. But to understand all these benefits, we first need a quick refresher on why traditional nuclear can be so sketchy. Traditional reactors use uranium-235. It's fissile, meaning it can absorb a neutron and split, releasing vast amounts of energy plus 3 more neutrons that can break up other uranium atoms, leading to a chain reaction. The trick in a nuclear reactor is to control the chain reaction and the rate of reactions. It's like trying to hold a bunch of mousetraps that are all set and ready to spring. If you lose control, you get a meltdown. And the waste it leaves behind? It's nasty stuff that stays dangerously radioactive for thousands of years. While the bulk of the weight of nuclear waste is relatively safe, about 5% of it's made up of highly radioactive spent fuel. 1% of this waste fuel is the remaining uranium that didn't burn. About 4% is made up of very dangerous radioactive daughter isotopes like cesium, plutonium, and polonium. This is 10,000 times more radioactive than the original uranium ore was and will remain that way for at least 100,000 years. It's a multi-generational problem we still haven't solved, and yet we're burning nuclear fuel by the boatloads, and it's crazy. And that's where the brilliant part comes in. Thorium on its own is not fissile, it's fertile. You can't just get it to split. You have to give it a little nudge. You hit it with a neutron from an outside source, which is usually uranium. It then goes through a series of nuclear reactions and turns into a fissile isotope of uranium, U-233, which we can then split to produce power. Getting the chain reaction to work requires bombarding it with neutrons. This means you can't have a runaway chain reaction with the fuel alone. In fact, thorium isn't really considered radioactive. You could store it at home and be fine. Not that I would recommend that. It does decay, but very slowly through millions of years. If you turn off that initial neutron source, the whole process stops. The fire goes out. The next question is, how are thorium reactors different? But before we get into that, I have to tell you about our sponsor this week, Jackery, and this, the HomePower 3000. This 3 kilowatt hour battery can output 3,600 watts, enough to power almost anything. For home backup power, this thing shines. Keep it plugged in so it's charged, and it'll be ready for action if ever an outage strikes. With 3,600 watts of output, it can power kitchen appliances like coffee makers, microwaves, and your fridge for 1 to 2 days. Keep your food fresh and prevent spoilage even during extended outages. It pairs nicely with Jackery's Solar Saga 200-watt panels for clean, renewable power, and the solar is amazing for camping, something we did a lot this summer. And being the world's smallest 3-kilowatt generator, it's easy to move around and easy to use. It has a 10-plus year lifespan thanks to reliable and safe lithium iron phosphate battery chemistry. With the HomePower 3000 and some solar panels, you can bring things like lights, induction cooktops, portable ACs, and a Starlink for the glamping enthusiasts. Whether it's for outdoor adventures or being prepared if the power goes out, the Jackery HomePower 3000 would be an amazing addition to your life. Check it out today using my links in the description and have power anywhere. Huge thanks to Jackery and you. Now back to the show. Now, there are a few different types of design, but I'm going to focus on the most interesting, which is the molten salt reactor, which is incredibly clever. Instead of solid fuel rods that can overheat, the thorium is dissolved along with the uranium starter in a liquid salt, usually molten lithium chloride, which melts at 600 degrees Celsius. This hot solution is pumped through the reactor core, where the chain reaction occurs and heats up the solution even more, then exits to a heat exchanger that can then use the heat to run a steam turbine. The rest is pretty straightforward. However, there are some nuances. Since you're pumping the fuel through the system, you can inject and remove molten solution during the cycle to replenish fuel or remove waste material without shutting down the reactor. This is an operational win compared to solid fuels. But the real genius lies in the reactor's inherent safety features. You might be thinking, why the reaction happens inside the core and not just outside as well, if it's the same molten salt full of fuel flowing around? And that's when I discovered a concept called critical geometry. This is the secret sauce behind the MSR's inherent safety. Think of it like building a fire inside a wood oven. The oven is the reactor core. If you stack your logs tightly together in a compact pile inside that oven, the heat from one log easily ignites the next, and the fire sustains itself. The oven walls also reflect part of that heat back inside, not letting it escape, making the fire more efficient. Now, if you take those same hot burning logs out of the oven and lay them end to end in a long single file line, or for our purposes, spread them out on a large surface like a heat exchanger, the fire will quickly die out. There's too much surface area and the heat dissipates before it can ignite the next log. The same principle applies to neutrons in an MSR. The reactor core is specifically designed as a geometrically favorable shape. Like a near sphere or a compact cylinder, the shape has a low surface area to volume ratio, which means the neutrons produced from the fission event is likely to hit another fuel nucleus before it can escape the core. The core is also typically surrounded by a neutron reflector like graphite, which acts like a mirror bouncing stray neutrons back into the fuel salt to cause more fissions. That would be like the fire in our oven. Everything outside the core is a different story. When the molten salt flows out of the core, it enters pumps, plumbing, and heat exchangers. These components are, by necessity, long and thin. They have a very high surface area to volume ratio. In this geometrically unfavorable shape, the vast majority of neutrons produced from the random fission event simply fly out of the salt and into the surrounding piping materials without ever hitting another fuel nucleus. The neutron population plummets and the chain reaction dies off. So, the system is engineered such that the fuel is only capable of sustaining a chain reaction when it is physically located inside the compact, reflected geometry of the core. Then there's the ultimate failsafe. A drain pipe at the bottom of the reactor core is plugged with a piece of frozen salt. If the plant loses all power, a fan cooling this plug shuts off, the plug melts, and the entire fuel drains via gravity into a containment tank where it's passively safe. No meltdown. Period. Now that is some elegant engineering. Okay, abundant fuel, incredible energy density, can't melt down, far less waste. This is all sounding like a no-brainer. So if you've been sitting here nodding along thinking, this is amazing, so why aren't we building these everywhere? This is where the story gets complicated, and we have to look at history, engineering, and bureaucracy. Hurdle one, the Cold War legacy.
He's got fish and cover. Got fish.
He did what we all must learn to do.
You
and you
and you
and you.
Duck, whoosh, and cover.
back in the 1950s and 60s, we were in a nuclear arms race. The uranium fuel cycle has a very convenient and very dangerous byproduct, plutonium, the stuff you need to make bombs. The thorium cycle doesn't. We chose a fuel that gave us weapons. It was a military decision that set our entire energy path up for the next 70 years. Hurdle number two, the engineering reality. This is a big one for me. Those molten salts, those are incredibly corrosive. We're talking about a radioactive, superheated chemical soup running at 700 degrees Celsius. Finding materials that can contain that for 40 years without turning into Swiss cheese is a massive, massive material science challenge that we're only now starting to crack. Hurdle number three, the regulatory nightmare. Every nuclear regulation in the US and most of the world was written for solid fuel, water-cooled uranium reactors. Trying to get a liquid-fueled, salt-cooled thorium reactor license is like trying to get a flying car approved by the DMV. The framework just doesn't exist. It would take a decade and billions of dollars just to write the rules, let alone build the plant. So then if things have changed, we've had some breakthroughs, and this is the age of thorium, is it really going to happen? I did some research to find out how many thorium reactors, or at least research projects, have been developed. And it turns out, over the last 75 years, only 19 projects have been started, and most of them shut down a few years later. There are only 10 active projects worldwide, and only one that may soon reach commercial scale. It's still early in the game, and thorium won't power everything tomorrow. The hype is a little ahead of the reality. But for the first time, the future of thorium is finally starting to feel present. China has a working experimental molten salt reactor right now, and is planning a commercial one by 2030. Startups in Denmark and the US are making real progress on the corrosion problem and reactor design. The pressure of climate change is forcing governments to finally look past the regulatory hurdles. The path is long, the engineering is tough, and the financial investment is huge. But the promise is just too great to ignore. Thorium, like every technology, isn't going to solve everything by itself. It'll be a tool in our toolkit. In engineering, there's no such thing as a magic bullet, but it is one of the most powerful, elegant, and promising tools we have in our engineering toolbox. We made a choice in the 1950s based on military needs, but now we have a chance to make a new choice based on our planet's needs. But the biggest change that will absolutely drive the development of thorium is the rise of AI and AI data centers. Companies like Microsoft and Google cannot build AI data centers fast enough, and it's not a problem of money. They have all the money to buy NVIDIA hardware under the sun. The problem that they are running into now is not having enough power available from utilities to build more data centers. And if power is a limiting factor, you can guarantee there's going to be all sorts of lobbying in Congress to get projects approved. And thorium solves so many of the problems that people have issue with when it comes to nuclear. And that's why I think we are seeing the perfect storm. The energy consumption is about to skyrocket because of AI, and solar and wind farms will continue to grow, but they might not be able to keep pace. And as we look to other alternatives, companies like Google are building geothermal, Microsoft is buying nuclear power plants. We are entering an age where nuclear power is going to be king again. And thorium probably stands to reap the most benefit. But what do you think? What does the future of thorium look like? And might it finally be time for its time in the sun? Sound off in the comments below. And don't forget to like and subscribe if you think we've earned it. We have a lot of really awesome content coming up here in the next couple of weeks. I'm Ricky with Tiba Da Vinci. Thank you so much for watching.